The Exorcist by William P. Blatty. Dramatized by Robert Forrest. Part 1.
We can talk in here, Lieutenant.
Yes, indeed.
Carl will be here in a minute. Would you like a drink?
Thank you, Mrs. McNeil, but no. Not even coffee this time. I kept you too long last time. Far too long. Your daughter?
Regan.
Regan, she's still not well. I can tell. It's in your eyes. Forgive me. You haven't been sleeping.
Not much. Lieutenant, if this is more about the night Burke died, I really don't know what else we can tell you.
Burke Dennings. A wonderful director. As English as David Lean and as sly as Orson Welles. Was he as difficult as both?
Burke was a dream to work with. He was gentle and patient and told schoolboy jokes.
But offstage, off the set, relaxing, refreshed.
Yes, when he was drinking, he could be difficult. In fact, well, he could be mean.
It's gossip. It's intrusive.
Who can resist gossip?
Not a lieutenant in the homicide division. But there's something different.
Different how?
How indeed. I got it. The clock. That beautiful clock on the wall. It stopped.
It does that.
It needs rewinding.
I don't think so.
You have to call in an expert.
It's temperamental.
You wish to see me, ma'am?
Yes, Carl. The lieutenant has a few more questions for you.
Details only, Mr. Anstrom.
I am happy to provide them, sir.
The night Mr. Dennings died, you were at the movies.
Poor Schofield in King Lear. It was excellent.
Well, Schofield is excellent. But the film, I... Never mind. Now, it's to do with time. With the times of your journey home. As exact as you remember.
Carl's times are always exact.
I saw the 6 o'clock showing at the Crest. The film lasts just over 2 hours. I am not sure about the minutes. I took a bus then from the front of the theater to Wisconsin Avenue, 9:20 perhaps. I walked from there to here. I arrived at 9:30 exactly. I remember, I glanced at my watch.
Admirable. Impressive.
Thank you, sir. That is all?
That's all, Mr. Anstrom.
Thank you, Carl.
Every detail fits, like carpentry, like a well-constructed screenplay. At the time of Mr. Denning's death, you were at a consultation with your doctor, the results of tests for your daughter. Your secretary was at the pharmacy, medication for the same patient. Your servant Carl was at the movies. His wife, your housekeeper, saw a movie that night, too.
Which one of us did you have doubts about?
Now, Mrs. McNeil, doubt, as you say, it's the job. Sometimes when I don't feel doubt, I have to act doubtful.
Burke was here. He was supposed to look after the place until one or other of us got back. For some reason, he left. He may well have forgotten why he was here in the first place. He was drunk. He fell down the steps out there, all the way down to M Street. Isn't that what happened?
Well, he was not robbed. Those steps are very steep. It's a long, long way to the bottom. But the nature of the injuries, the severity...
Please, Lieutenant, not too much detail. It's all right, really it is.
It was heavy, Mrs. McNeil.
Oh, yes, a cabinet. I think that's what it was. It must have been. Carl and Billy, they're moving some furniture around.
Accidents happen. Mm-hmm. The home is the most dangerous place in the world for accidents. Ah, yes. Temperamental.
It does that.
Well, I trouble you and yours no more. Your daughter, I wish her well.
Thank you.
You're keeping her out of drafts like I advised.
Of course.
And you have the best of doctors.
Well, I hope they're the best. They're certainly numerous. But we may have to try another... something new, someone new.
I am not fit, Father. I am unfit for the work. I'm a priest and a psychiatrist, but I should not be a counselor to these young men.
Damien, you're the most popular counselor the university's ever had.
Yesterday, one came to me with the old question about loving his neighbor. Some of his neighbors are junkie hustlers who would kill for a pair of shoes, let alone a fix.
It is an old question, and you know the answer.
God does not ask of us what is psychologically impossible. The love God demands is not an emotion, it is an act of will. We must act with love. Yes, Father President, I've been trained to know the answers and in how to give them.
It's not like you to sound the cynical note, Damien.
I'm sorry, but I want to transfer. A teaching post, psychiatry, New York, if possible. Then I'd be closer to my mother.
I can't decide that alone. I'll have to talk to the bishop, and he thinks very highly of your work here.
Please tell the bishop that I know it as surely as I felt my vocation when I was 18. I should not be a counselor.
And if God or the bishop demands that act of love from you...
Father, when they come to me about sex or loneliness, all that I can deal with. But when they come to me with questions of faith, I am not the one to help them. I'm not fit. I can't even meet their eye.
Father, can you help an old Arthur boy? Enough for train fare and maybe a cup of coffee?
I have about $1.50 on me. I need it for train fare, too.
You could spare a few cents. Charity, Father. Compassion. I'm a Catholic. I swear I am.
I'm truly sorry.
What are you saying? You got nothing but prayers for me? That all you can offer? Our Father, who art in poverty? Ah, look at you. Staring straight ahead. Hey, I'm over here! I'm right here, Father, dying of it all! And a dying man needs a drink! Well, help an old doctor, boy!
Who would have thought you'd turn out a priest? The kind of boy you were?
Mama, we need to stop talking about the past. We need to talk about now, the future.
Good stories in the past. Even when I was out selling plastic flowers and clothes pegs, there was always good stories. Even when you were out breaking windows, breaking heads. Why do you do this, Dimmy? I used to say, why do you do this to me? You remember I used to say that? Still, you straightened out.
That's right, I studied.
And there was all that exercising and running and boxing. Oh, Jesus save us. The hoodlums that hung out in that gym.
Listen, before I forget, here's a 20. I'll put it here in your purse.
Keep your eye on the soup. Don't let it boil. You just gotta gently warm it through. No boiling. Mrs. Corelli, 2 flights down. She's gone.
What about her 18 cats? I was sure I could still smell them.
Why do you do this to me, Dimmy? I must have said that a million times.
How's your nurse been in this week?
And then that plaque thing appears on your wall.
What plaque?
You don't remember? It was just there one morning on your bedroom wall. What's he stealing now, I thought.
Why would I steal a plaque? What was it?
Big red cross in the middle, writing top and bottom. My brother is in pain. I share his pain.
Dear God.
I meet God in him. I got that right?
I haven't thought about that for years.
See? Good stuff in the past. And now here I am, Mary Karras. And my boy Dimmy is a priest.
I'm a doctor, too.
Kinda.
Yeah. Kind of a doctor.
But an all-the-way priest. And still you managed to burn the soup!
Just keep moving, creep, or I'll call a cop.
Miss McNeil, I'm Father Karras. Oh,
Jesus, so you are. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. I should have warned you I wouldn't be in uniform. But you seem to want this meeting to be,
Inconspicuous, yes. Can we walk a little?
Sure.
You're wondering why I asked to meet with you. You in particular, I mean, not just any priest.
Yes, I'm wondering that.
I got your name from Father Dyer. He's a friend of yours, right?
Joe is an excellent friend.
He was at a party of mine.
I know.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.